Okay, now let her come towards you.
Now you come towards me.
Ow. Ow.
Ow.
Ow.
Ow. Ow. Okay. Ow.
I'm actually really good. I'm just kidding with you.
I'm actually really good. I'm just kidding around with you.
Do you believe me? How good I am?
Do you believe me? How good I am?
Yeah. Good. Just in case, I'm going to prove it to you.
Okay, just in case. I'm going to prove it to you right now.
I'm gonna have my friend come in, Soren. Oh, in case you don't know, Soren Thompson is the 2012 World Team Champion from the U.S. Olympic team that I decided to call and have come in. And
that's not true. That's
an Olympic fencer?
So you're just going to, you're going to fence Soren.
An Olympic fencer?
Okay, I have to admit, this is pretty funny. I'm not going to really point out a whole lot of mistakes because, you know, part of the joke is that he doesn't know how to fence. So I could nitpick about his form all day long, but I'm not going to because that's not really fair. The only thing I would like to really point out is the type of mask that he's using. He's using a saber mask. You could tell because it's all shiny and silver, meaning it's conductive. But more importantly, I'm not totally sure when this was filmed, so it was probably during a time that this was okay, but the fact that they're using a saber mask was probably just a mistake. They just grabbed one, like the first one that fit. Because the thing is, if they're practicing their fencing dry, technically it doesn't really matter. The only difference between a saber mask and a foil or an epee mask is that the saber is designed to be detected by the machine when it gets hit. But in terms of fencing dry, technically it doesn't make a difference. The odd thing is that he's using a mask that has a visor in it. Now, for anyone who doesn't know, at around the year 2008, I believe, a new type of mask was starting to become available to foil, epee, and saber fencers. And it was the one that he's using right now. It had a clear visor in it. Now, the thing is, fencing masks are very easy to see through. They're made of a mesh material that is very strong, but because it's so close to your eyes, from far away, even though it looks like it's hard to see through, it's actually not. It's very easy to see through it. But the thing is, having a clear eye visor instead of mesh can provide you with perhaps 1% better visibility. Now the thing is, that's not very much, it's hardly anything, but to Olympic fencers and fencers who travel the world going to international tournaments and competing in World Cups, they'll go for any tiny advantage they can get. So at the more elite levels, this mask started to become very, very popular. It was the kind of thing that you started seeing fencers on TV use all the time, but if you went to a local tournament, even to a big one like a regional or maybe even a national one, then you wouldn't really see these often, if at all. They weren't really common because most fencers just didn't need that for the type of money. The reason why I bring it up, though, is that kind of mask is actually no longer allowed. In 2009, on November 1st, an injury was reported at a national foil event, I believe. I don't exactly remember where, but basically what happened is the foil of a fencer broke and then continued. He didn't continue fencing, it just, he continued his momentum. And the broken end of the foil caught the edge of the visor and actually went through it. There was a reported injury, but the fencer that was afflicted managed to return back to the bout after a standard 10-minute medic break. So he wasn't seriously injured, thank God, but due to the fact that it was an injury that was on his head, so close to his eyes, through a piece of equipment that was supposed to be very safe, it was something that was certainly worth looking after, even though there was only one other report in an epee bout of a visor not standing up to it. From what I looked up, basically, they realized that the material was not quite as strong as they originally thought. In fact, it said that I think some, but it might have been all, of the visors made were not exactly 100% the type of material that they were promised, so they were a little bit weaker. Now, they were still very strong. Remember, these kinds of visors lasted the kinds of hits that you could get from Olympic and world champions. And it went on for like a solid at least a year, maybe two, before this incident happened. But the point is, even though it happened like once, it was enough that after a closer inspection, they were like, we're not taking this risk again. So those types of masks are actually not allowed anymore. So it's kind of interesting. I mean, I realize I'm watching this clip very late. I don't really watch this show. So I know that this was filmed years ago. I don't know exactly when, but it was clearly during a time that those visor masks were still in circulation. So if you're wondering why one mask has an eye visor and the other mask does not, that is why. Quickly want to bring up something that they put in the little notes there. When he started bleeding from the hand, and in his defense, they typically wear gloves when fencing. That is true, having one glove is required in any type of fencing, but the non-fencing hand is usually uncovered. It is possible to wear a glove during that, but it's not very common whatsoever, because the gloves had to be fairly thick to, they had to be held to certain requirements so that the blades can't penetrate. But the thing is, when you're fencing, you become very sweaty and everything, and you usually use that offhand as something to, you know, help plug in and everything. So if it doesn't have to be covered, most people don't do it. And you really don't get hit there very often. The thing is, you're actually supposed to have your arm away from your body, no matter what type of fencing you're doing. So most fencers don't get hit there, not because they're not wearing a glove, but just because it's usually out of the way. So the fact that they threw him into this, knowing that he doesn't know how to fence, it probably would have been a smart idea to quickly find a left-handed glove and put it on him. But realistically, fencers are not required to do that whatsoever. In my entire fencing experience, which is more than 10 years, I've only ever seen one person wear an additional glove on their left hand. Most people just don't even do it, because you're supposed to have it out of the way anyways. So, you know, it's usually just so unnecessary. So when they say one typically wears gloves when fencing, if you're talking about the fencing hand, that's absolutely true because it's required. But if you're talking about a second glove for the non-fencing hand, that's actually not true at all.
So what did we learn?
Never go up against an Olympian.
Will you take another class with me?
Maybe. So that's the end of the first one. We're gonna look at another one real quick. I want to mention something that I think a lot of people kind of get wrong, not just about coaching fencing, but really in terms of coaching any sport. Fencing and teaching someone how to fence are two entirely different skill sets. You obviously have to know how to fence in order to teach someone else, but it's not required for you to be some sort of Olympian in order to actually do it and being able to do it well. Now, if you have that kind of experience, that's very good. But I've seen plenty of fencers who had, you know, regularly gone to nationals, had gone to international events. I've never met an Olympian, unfortunately, but I've met a lot of very good fencers, and a lot of them were terrible coaches. Like, some of them were okay, some of them were good, but being able to fence really well doesn't necessarily translate to being able to teach fencing very well. So I've seen this kind of stereotype before, how you can't be a coach if you've, you know, never been to the top level. And while, like I just said, it is true that if you have been at that level, it certainly helps, it is actually not required. But let's go ahead and take a look at the second one. From what I've seen so far, it's the same basic setup, but with a different guy.
like an adult-born baby.
I real quickly want to point out something about what he's wearing. In the last one, the dude was wearing shorts, which for Epe, you probably don't want to do because the legs are valid target area. But if you're teaching someone who's new and is probably not going to be aiming for that anyways, it's usually fine. But what I want to point out in this one is not just the fact that he has one of those old masks that is also a saber mask. And in fact, this looks like the same club, but you can tell where his wire is coming out of his sleeve. It looked like it was set up by someone who wasn't too sure about what to do, so probably just by him. But the wire is actually supposed to be coming out of just above the gauntlet into the cord. It's not supposed to come out underneath the gauntlet at the very bottom and then work its way up to the weapon. It's just an efficiency thing, but especially for Epe, it can also be a safety measure, because you can aim for the glove in Epe, and even if you can't, you know, not everyone is perfect, so it's entirely possible for your opponent's blade to get caught in that wire, and then, you know, that can be a safety issue.
Fucking guard ass. Now, your feet, stay there! Stay there! So let me see your form. Okay, remember to bend your knees.
Unteachable.
So, a skip forward like that. Try it.
Unteachable.
He's given up on her in 2 minutes. Yeah.
Now, when you want to lunge at someone.
All the way back. All the way back.
Yeah, so see how I do it.
Now, leap forward. All the way. Come back.
Tell you can't touch us as you pass it.
Can't touch us.
I just noticed they have different weapons. The guy pretending to be the coach is using a foil, and the woman is using an epee. I've been ignoring a lot of their form and everything, because, like I said before, this isn't meant to actually portray fencing. They know that he doesn't know how to fence, and they're not really, you know, trying to make it accurate. But I think anyone with more than a week of experience would realize that they're using different weapons.
Let's try squaring off against each other, okay?
When she charges you, yell no like a teenage girl.
Ready? Come for me. No! Come toward me. No! 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 Not bad, though. Do you think you would be interested in taking another fencing class with me?
I don't know if I'm cut enough for this.
No! 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 No!
Okay, that's the end of that. As much as I don't want to give this credit, because I do teach people, and seeing coaches portrayed in such a light, especially, you know, making fun of the sport that I love so much, I have to admit that was pretty funny. But since they're not trying to portray fencing or anything, I'm not going to give it a score for accuracy. I do have to say, though, it was pretty satisfying to watch an Olympian beat up a dude who didn't know what they were doing. I don't know, maybe I'm just weird like that. But that was the end of that. I hope you enjoyed it, and I will see you next week. Bye.